So you want a completely secure microcontroller. Of course you do. We all do. You show me one design today, just one, where security is not an issue, and I'll give you $1 million. What?
Oh, I can't promise that? Oh. Well, but they'll never collect.
Okay, $1 million aside. Yes, we all want software IP protection, a strong, secure boot, and protection against fault attacks. We also want pie for breakfast, never to go to the gym and never gain a pound, and ride a dragon to work. Okay, maybe you want to teleport to work instead. I get it. Parking those dragons can be a bit of a pain. And we can have those secure microcontrollers with a little help from PUF, Physically Unclonable Functions. Hi, I'm Amelia Dalton, host of Chalk Talk. In this episode, Kris, Ardis from Maxim Integrated introduces us to Maxim's first secure micro with ChipDNA PUF technology. Kris and I dig into the details of this new microcontroller, what PUF brings to the party, spoiler alert, it's a lot, and how this new microcontroller bridges the secure and non-secure areas of your next design. And before we get started, don't forget to click that link. There you can find even more information about Maxim's first secure micro with ChipDNA PUF technology. Hi, Kris. Thank you so much for joining me.
Hi, Amelia. Thanks for talking to me again.
Okay, so we are here to talk about Maxim's new secure microcontroller. So why exactly did Maxim design this part?
We've got a long history in providing advanced security technology, and I don't know that I really need to convince people that security is important. If I do, you're probably watching the wrong Chalk Talk, and you can move on to the next one. But I think we've all seen the fear presentations that list all the stuff you see on the left here and all the possible bad things that can go wrong. So if you haven't seen that, I refer you to the internet. But what I want to talk about it is we've got a new part with the absolute most advanced key security technology that we think will be broadly applicable to lots of different types of markets. And the reason key security technology is so crucial is all of the encryption, all of the secure operations that happen in chips, they're all only as good as the protection on the secret key. It's like your key to your house. If you lose it, what good is it really protecting if it's out there for somebody to pick up on the street? If that key is protected, then an attacker has to do something more difficult. They have to break down the front door. They have to figure out how to sneak past your alarm on the window. That's why the secret key is so important, is because it's the front door. And if you have good protection there, you force attackers to take other more difficult routes.
Okay, so you say you've got the best key technology. What is it?
So we call it ChipDNA, and that's our implementation of a physically unclonable function. And so let me take a step back first, talk about how secret keys can be stored. Secret key is just a long number. It's 64 bits or 128 bits or 256 bits. It could be stored in an SRAM or a flash or an EEPROM or something like that. The challenge with things like flash and EEPROM is you can remove power from the part and people can microprobe it. The challenge with SRAM is it goes away. And even if you got battery back to SRAM, that's better because you can tie that to sensors and delete the key when necessary, but the key's still in there. And so as long as the chip's powered up, a dedicated enough attacker can maybe get down and take a look at the thing. ChipDNA is a different approach to that. Rather than actually storing the number, what we do is we look at very small noise signals, very small and minute differences in the silicon itself that are different from chip to chip, even on the same wafer sitting right next to each other. And we essentially amplify those differences, and it generates the numbers that have nice randomness properties. So what does all that mean? So what that all means is that you can generate one of these random-looking secret numbers on each of these parts, and we've got lots of great data to show how different they'll be, that it won't be the same number, but also how reliable it is. Even though we're amplifying noise, we can do it in a very reliable way. That gives us a very secure, unique number for each chip. That's why we call it DNA. Forget the inconvenient analogy of twins for a moment. It's like DNA because it's very much inherently tied to you, tied to that one particular chip, very unique for that one particular chip.
That sounds really cool. And why do we need this?
Yeah, I'm going to get a little bit back into the fear, but I won't do too much of that. Basically, attacks available today that are available to like university students with commonly available equipment and open source software, that was the advanced attack 10 years ago. security attacks are becoming more and more aggressive and sophisticated over time. And so we're always trying to up the game in terms of the level of security for these devices. If you deploy something in the field, you want to know that it's not going to be susceptible to an attack that's going to be available in 2 years commonly. You want things to be to last 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, depending on what you're designing. And so that's why we've upped the game in terms of the key protection technology we implement.
So how does PUF technology help with these kinds of threats?
So a lot of these threats are analysis type of attacks, where you either physically analyze the memory or you use a lot of side channel analysis to try to extract the data that is the key. PUF technology, if you try to physically look at the cell itself, if you try to physically detect what's there, you're actually changing the characteristics of that circuit such that the random number that's inherently stored in there produces something different. So I like to think of it kind of like Heisenberg's uncertainty principle that, you know, if you try to look at it, and I'm sure the science isn't being described right here, but if you try to look at it, it looks different than what it really is. So that's one thing. It's very impervious to physical kinds of attacks. The other thing that's nice about PUF technology is that we generate the key for use only when it needs to be used. And as soon as we're done doing an encryption operation or a validation operation, the key goes away. And so it's not there for an attacker to come by after the fact and try to uncover the key.
Okay, but we're here to talk about Maxim's first micro with PUF technology, so let's get into that.
So the first microcontroller that we're introducing with PUF technology is a MAX32520, and it's got two stories. The first story is it's, simply put, it's the first PUF-based broad market secure microcontroller. Lots of other secure micros that are commonly available are really targeted for something like a financial terminal or a military application. When you look under the hood of this thing, it's really kind of a general purpose, nice, low power Cortex M4F that happens to have some of the most advanced security technology available on the planet. The second story is that it can also be the most advanced secure boot coprocessor for any generic microprocessor or microcontroller that you might have in your system.
All right, let's talk about this first story.
So story number one, it's just a useful ultra secure microcontroller. So like I said, it's a Cortex M4F. It runs at 120 megahertz. It's super low power. It's got all the things you would expect to see from a typical off-the-shelf microcontroller, like SPI, like UART, I2C, GPIOs, and then a fair amount of memory, 2 megs of flash and 170 kilobytes of SRAM. Then you put beyond that, you see pretty powerful encryption engines, things that can implement elliptic curve crypto, things that can implement AES. True random number generation, and then security monitors to help you try to detect if your system has come under attack. And so you can use this in lots of different applications. I'll move on here and show you one potential use of this is as a bridge between the non-secure world and the secure world. The closer you can put this device to sensors or communication interfaces, you can encrypt that data and then pass it on to your non-secure general purpose processor. That way, all of the high secure operations like key management, like the decryption and encryption, all happen in this very secure boundary.
Okay, so what's story number two?
So story number two is super unique for this part. There's nothing else quite like this on the market. What we can do here is we can behave like an external flash memory to any other generic microcontroller or microprocessor in your system. Here's what that really means. So we've got this 2 megabytes of internal flash that we actually will appear like we are just a flash memory to the system micro that can start executing it out of. Before we let that happen, though, we first boot up. We do a secure cryptographic validation of that memory, make sure it's okay, make sure it's the memory we intended to run. If not, we set warnings and red lights and alarms and all kinds of stuff like that. If it's okay, then we let the microcontroller start to execute out of our memory. Then, you know, 2 megabytes probably isn't going to be enough to run Linux or something like that. So then the processor can, from a secure root of trust, start to validate the rest of the memories in the system. The reason this is better than other technologies, one, we've got the PUF-based secure keys, so that provides really high level security on the keys that are going to be used for that validation. But because we are running that validation on this coprocessor, rather than having the generic micro or generic microprocessor run that validation and then check with some kind of external device, we're fundamentally changing where the security decision is made. And that security decision is being made inside the secure box that is the MAX32520, rather than kind of being shared between the generic processor and some external memory or something like that.
So you mentioned before that it wasn't really for payment applications. Where are you seeing people wanting to use this?
So we think that as people get more sophisticated about, you know, security attacks and their connected devices being potentially exposed, that we're going to see lots and lots of different applications. But we're seeing some commonality in terms of the folks who are standing up and are saying, hey, I'm more interested right now. Things like telematics boxes that go in cars or trucks and monitor driver behavior. Maybe it's a fleet of commercial trucks. Things like drones, utility monitoring devices, where they're just out in the field, they're available, they're at risk for somebody getting physical access to these devices. And then other very high-profile types of applications like medical applications, where there's a lot of concern about privacy of data, security of the transmission, or even communication markets, where there's a high risk of cloning of the devices or high risk of tampering with the devices because there's sensitive data going across all those things. So you see a couple common things. One is either super sensitive data or devices that are out in the field and susceptible to a bad guy coming and grabbing the device and doing something bad with it.
This is super cool, Kris. What are the next steps?
So the next steps, we've got EV kits available, and it's available in a nice, pretty friendly 32-pin TQFN package. So we've got parts, we've got kits, we've got tool support for it through Eclipse. And then the other nice thing is no NDA is needed. You've seen a lot of secure microcontrollers and more secure applications. You see that there's NDAs required, which, you know, a lot of people don't really like so much. They're not so comfortable with signing documents or, you know, contracts with big, nasty, evil corporations. We've taken all that away. We want to enable this security to go into all kinds of applications and help secure all the embedded devices around us.
Excellent. Well, I think that's all I have time for today. Thank you so much for joining me, Kris.
Thank you, Amelia.
And before we go, you didn't forget to click that link, did you? There you can find even more information about Maxim Integrated's first secure micro with ChipDNA PUF technology. For Chalk Talks, I'm Amelia Dalton from eejournal.com. For more Chalk Talks, head on over to the Chalk Talks section of EE Journal. You can't miss it. It's right across the top. Or head on over to YouTube, youtube.com/eejournal.